start moving tomorrow. Try to move a wire, just because I need to bring a check.
Tell you what, that's good, Tyler.
Yeah, thank you.
It's okay, I'm gonna have Ryan move as soon as.
I think I always believe something. There's a line of Goethe that says like something like the poet might know what he wanted to write, but he will never know what he wrote. You know? So, I mean, and I think that's true. That you go through a process, you do your best wanting to go there, but then at the end, by all the process that you went through, that obviously you have to adapt. At the end, you never know exactly what you end up writing, you know? Time, this was like 5 years ago, I was going through a difficult period, you know, in a way that I was trying to find something else and approach things in a different way and get out of my comfort zone. And I'm not saying this lightly, I think you have to be a little kind of crazy to embark in a film like this. The physicality of it, the setting, the nature as a transformative experience, that was exactly what I wanted personally to go through in my personal life. So suddenly I thought, I would love to be submersed 1 year in the nature. I didn't know what I was thinking about. I was crazy, because it's harder than you think. I think it was pretty clear since the beginning who was part of this cloth of madness. We are less and less used to be exposed to the real elements and try to solve it with the reality in every level. It's a transforming experience. To get through so many challenges every day, as if there's a puzzle that is already written and you just have to find the right piece to fit in that precise moment in that corner and cannot be other way because if not, doesn't fit. So it's until you find that piece and shape it that is perfect, that fit, if not all the puzzle collapse. And scary because that involved a lot of people, a lot of money, a lot of risk. Taking, you know, this is not a tiny intimate film in an apartment. It's involving a lot of things, and you don't know the answer. You don't know if you will succeed. Most likely not. Maybe we didn't. And the amount of hours and passion and trying to get the very best and try to figure out how to make this experience palpable for people in a different way that they have seen this period of time. Was scary.
Thank you. Revenant was a screenplay that I had read years before, but it had never been greenlit because of the complications and how to shoot some of the locations. What Alejandro accomplishes is his ability to put you there, this almost virtual reality where you really feel like you're out in the elements with these characters. You really feel immersed in their lives, and you get the visual perspective of this, of a character in the movie almost.
Enough of this shit! We'll never make it across like this
country! He's burning up.
A few glasses, you know, stuff of legend by, you know, the American campfires. He's a real-life Paul Bunyan type of character, man that survived extreme elements and was left to die by his hunting crew and buried alive and crawled through the entire American wilderness on his own through hundreds of miles through the dead of winter to seek revenge on the men that had done him wrong. So he's this sort of part of American folklore, but he was a real person and these things really did happen. But I think more than anything, what Alejandro wanted to do was create poetry in that story, the poetry of what it means to have all the chips stacked against you, to have really very little chance at survival and the sort of triumph of the human spirit and what we can endure and what we go through and what Hugh Glass realizes on that journey and whether revenge is ultimately the thing that will quench his thirst at the end of the day.
You know, the pulse or the heart of the film lies on the father and son relation. All my films, by some reason, I always have had that, you know? You can have sons or not, but you are a son of somebody, and that will always define you forever.
Your boy, he's seen a lot. He got a mother you need to get him back to?
I thought that the father and son story will make a dimension in the character that will not just be about the gun or about a revengeful thought of you abandon me, but when a filial relation is involved, it just get a much more powerful understanding of your being and your reason to be. So it was not like just as easy as sometimes they want to see, like Indians against white people. No, having Indian blood will make a much more complex situation for both of them in the middle with the Western trappers.
Daddy Ganesh. Daddy Ganesh.
Hugh Glass is not a traditional fur trapper. He has, you know, a son that is, you know, both white and Indian. And the unique set of challenges that he has as a father and his son has growing up in an environment like that is something that is an undertone throughout the movie. It's never overt, it's never spoken, but you get the essence that they're alone in this world. And so the father-son bond becomes a very powerful thing because he needs to teach his son to sort of disappear, to not be there, to, you know, just keep your head down and focus on what you need to do.
Tagihit ka mo. Tagihit ka mo.
So what do you think people say back home
about the Revenant, huh?
I mean, like, historically, natives haven't been portrayed correctly at all in any type of, like, real art form, especially, like, Hollywood cinema. I don't know, I was just kind of afraid of that.
Thank you.
basically, I just don't want another film of people pushing their agenda on me or on our people, saying this is how we see you and pushing it as like us and them, you know? Every tribe has its own story, and of course our ancient stories and our creation stories, but there's the modern story of why this lake is even here.
I mean, this is like what Grandma talks about all the time. Remember that photo we've seen online? You see all those, everyone in Congress signing this land away and signing it to the Army Corps of Engineers to build this dam. Everyone who was displaced here. Like, do you remember that picture?
I think it's just a deep wound for a lot of people who live here, and it's a symbol of the movement and destruction of our culture.
Many themes that the film, in a way, deals with as a context, as a frame, I think they are very permanent and relevant today.
Fur trade was a massive, lucrative business. And these men went into this sort of pristine landscape, and the truth is we massacred a lot of the indigenous population for these resources. And to me, what's relevant about it is, you know, here we are at this day and age, seeing what we've done to our planet. There are similar themes there. To me, it's like the first steps towards this sort of massive undertaking that mankind has put forth to extract resources from our environment, and at what cost.
It seemed like it was just overnight. The people didn't know what to expect. They were signing leases for pennies compared to what these oil companies are making off of the wells that they drilled on the reservation.
I think the Indians in the time of our film were cautiously welcoming the trade, but they didn't. You know, it's like in Jamestown, the Indians welcomed the English colonists, but they didn't expect them to stay.
Some companies are good, don't get me wrong. Some companies are good. They actually help the community. They donate back to the community. But then there's a lot of fly-by-nights who are in and gone. They don't care.
You know, we've seen the car accidents go way up. And a lot of house fires from drugs and stuff like that. Just a lot of fatalities and oil field accidents in general.
The greed of everybody coming west, you know, wanting those beaver skins, you know, they didn't matter whose land it was. If it had a treasure on there, we were going to get it.
This is where we originally were. So if you can imagine underwater, this is where the tribe and our family were doing very well. But then with the coming of the dam, that's when that way of life was taken away again too. You think of history and these things happening way long time ago, but it's in our lifetime and it's still happening.
Hey, Glass. Is it true what they say about you shooting that lieutenant while you was living them sandwiches?
It's Gerald.
The rejection of the otherness and the fear of the otherness. I think in every part of the world, people has lived together and they don't like each other, but you don't kill the other just because you don't like it or because it's different.
Is that what you did? Shot one of your own to save this little dog right
he
here?
Didn't know what they wanted to
fight, son. Why, was you playing with this little boy's mama, huh?
It's Gerald!
Did he kill her? Hey, you can quit polishing that rifle when I'm talking to you.
Fitzgerald is precisely that. He can't stand the fact that somebody can have a half-breed son involved with other society that he considers inferior, that he don't understand, and by not understanding, he's afraid. But at the same time, I always want Fitzgerald not to be a villain, because I don't consider people who are racist, bad people. I think they are just ignorant, and by not having the knowledge or the conscience or the awareness, they are irresponsible, and they can bring a lot of pain.
Tell me right now, and be honest, did you see him?
Put your rifle
down. Did you see the read? Hey!
Tom Hardy, in a way, embraced that character with such a complexity without falling into the cliches and a stereotype of the bad racist guy, but a guy that is a victim of his own culture, you know?
I giant! I hate you!
The worst thing you can do looking at history is to judge people in historical settings on today's values and interpretations. You've got to put your mind back there. You've got to understand the total picture and what their philosophies about life and religion and everything else were. But people that really saw the country when it still belonged to God or the mountain men. They were the first ones to see it besides the natives that lived here. I want to know their story. I want to know what they felt about the country and how they saw it and how, if they appreciated it, if they really understood what it was all about. I like to equate it to any other time in history when there's economic need to make a living. And these men were frontiersmen. They were Kentuckians, they were Virginians, they were Tennesseans, they were Scotch, they were Irish, they were Spanish, they were French, they were Canadians. They were from all sources.
Those not. When them boots is clean, I want you to hoop them up real tight.
$200 per annum. At a time when an average man made, you know, $10 a month.
Okay. Rees is what the mountain men called
them. And beaver were worth $5 a pound, which a good beaver weighed a little over a pound. That's quite a bit of money. There is an importance to understanding your history.
Two triggers, you gotta set the back trigger first.
The history of your family, the history of your area, the history of your ethnicity, whatever it is. If you have an understanding of where you came from and how you got here, because the events that brought us all to where we are now did not happen in a vacuum. There's a cause and effect why these things happen. Learn those causes and effects. What caused those men to be here at a certain time? Why were they here? What were they after? What made them think that way?
The irony is it was all based on a fur top hat. The look of men in Europe changed, and this hat became a status symbol. And that said, they all wanted a beaver hat. Every man, it was, you couldn't dress up without it. And so there was like a 20-year period where the beaver population of America was almost wiped out, where a choice was made to make money over a population of animals, of people, of environment. And I think this movie on a positive side, you know, really shows what the fur trade, you know, did and how both Native Americans suffered and our psyches, I think, suffer.
By the Coast Guard after 2,700 liters of bunker fuel spilled from a freighter in English Bay back in April. Jill Bennett is following this story for us and joins us now from downtown Vancouver with more on what the report says.
Well, Sam, it's 90 pages long, as you mentioned, 25 recommendations made by John Butler in this report. You can boil it down, though, to one word, communication. It finds great lack in communication of some of those things that have been addressed since.
Being on this production has motivated me. I remember being on set and I felt the character that I'm playing and the kind of warrior he is. It's inspired me. Whoever thought a Skid Row kid would be working with Tom and Leo and Alejandro. I've never dreamed that.
Everything we have for the story.
Alk Dog. I try to my best ability to make people feel him. There were certain scenes that were just powerful.
Just start swinging and Damien come and picked him up and his legs kicking and he's still hiding. He's getting packed off.
No, I'm grateful that I'm allowed to sit here on your land, you know, and to share our experiences that we go through.
Did you know my dad too?
Yeah. I was just young boy. We are people of the land, First Nations people.
But having that opportunity,
we're going to fight till a bitter end for the land. And a lot of people don't realize how much poison that's been going through. It's all about money. It's all about ownership. It's all about them.
When do you think oysters stop showing up here?
I know, I think they're more delicate than the clams and crabs because it seems like they went first.
Like 50 years ago?
Yeah, there's a leak in one of these oil refineries and they said they're not going to fix it.
The Squamish and the Tsleil-Waututh Nation people lived off of that water. Now they can't even swim in it. They can't even swim in it now.
Capitalism as we know it, where if you understand it as use natural resources as your own convenience to get profit, not understanding the surrounding and not respecting animals and nature and societies just for the fact of getting what you need. I think we are still digging and cutting and, you know, extracting every natural resource we can. But I don't know when we will understand that, you know, until we kill the last animal and we eat the last fish and we cut the last tree, we will understand that we are not able to eat money. You know, there's gonna be a moment that we will realize that. And yes, of course, this is happening all around the world.
I'm not talking for myself anymore. I'm a mother, grandmother, great-grandmother. I only think about my future generations. There comes a time in your life, stand up for something. It doesn't have to be this way. We can change. We have a whale song. I don't know if you remember it.
Somehow you're gonna have to have an ability to understand what resources can be used and how much. I think the mountain men saw that the day was coming where the beaver were gonna be pretty scarce. So the mistakes that were made during this era, were repeated in generations after that, when it came to mining and timber and things like that.
We keep climbing until we reach our gate.
Every generation can see it. I don't understand why we don't study it, but or learn from it. But we can see it.
Captain.
For me, it was interesting because I got to play a character that wasn't very verbal. So it was different for me because I had to convey a lot of that without words or in a different language. It was almost like doing a documentary in a lot of ways, because when you do a movie, you can plan a lot of stuff out structure-wise as far as what the story is going to be beforehand, but really the elements of nature came into play a lot while doing this movie. We had to sort of adapt to our surroundings, so it was the closest thing to a documentary I think I've ever done as far as an actor is concerned. It was reacting to what nature gave us.
I knew that the weather and the autumn and the winter will be transforming the landscape, it will be transforming the actors, it will be transforming our psyche, our spirit, our emotional state. So by navigating the same season and exposing our bodies and mind to the same season in chronological order, allow me, all the crew, and especially the actors to get into a journey emotionally and physically that allow them to bring those emotions to the characters and feel it.
Yeah.
Alejandro made this story much more interesting because he got into the spiritual life of Glass and into his mind. And I think that we probably all grow with suffering, you know, and I think that it was a growth for him, that he, you know, when he found he wasn't dead and he had to live again, then he could, you know, approach it as a whole new life.
Arthur, Raquelas, I live in Fort Worth, Texas.
And where? What's your? Are you Navajo?
Yes.
Do you speak the language?
Just a little.
When Alejandro told me that you were an actor, that was a huge awakening for me because I never thought of myself as one. I'm just a driver in Texas, delivering gas and fuel to these stations, and all of a sudden I'm on this big, huge production set. Where does that come from? How does that happen? How does all that come about?
This is just a picture of grandfather a long time ago, when he was young. Just the preparation for battle in life, as well as, you know, in our spiritual lives. And he took me to be under his wing and teaching, and to be his next to take his place.
He was a Navajo guy, and he was a well-known businessman, even on the reservation, because a lot of people, you know, because I didn't even realize the role I was really even preparing for that he was working with me on as I was growing up in who I was, or who I, you know, because I think he even had an idea exactly who I was going to be, but I couldn't even see that at the time he did.
I was trained as even as a young kid was to be a medicine man, and on this journey I've kind of learned how to become one, and then actually doing it on film was a whole little big thing, you know, a whole big, you know, awakening.
Even singing over Leo and praying over Leo, I could mentally prepare, but if I'm not spiritually prepared, then I won't be mentally ready. And that took a lot of faith, trust, you know, to build up.
I think that, yes, Arthur, in a way, was such a pleasant, positive presence in the set that it's true. He always bring that energy that you need when you are stressed. And I love how many of these guys, Arthur and Dwayne, and many of the other Indian actors that work around them, in a way, they have always this spiritual dimension of the existence. You know, they are aware of, you know, other realities rather than what really is in front of their nose. I remember one beautiful thing when I was interviewing one of the guys. His second name was Starlight. I don't remember his first name, but the Starlight told me, you know, you see these lands in outside the office, this is where I live. I have lived all my life here. He was like 50 years old. And I said, what you have been doing? He said, well, I hunt, I fish, but not anymore. And I said, why you don't fish or you don't hunt anymore? He said, well, because I make a deal with nature. And there it is. That was Starlight looking at me. And basically he told me that 3 years ago, he has an adolescent boy who went out at night to the forest with his friends, and he never returned. And they were really afraid that he was dead. And he went out to the woods praying and begging to the nature to return his boy. And one day later, the boy came back. And the promise he did when he asked nature to bring his boy back. He said, if you do that, I will never kill any animal, and I will never cut a plant, and I will never eat a fish. And the nature came with his son, and now he was not able and promised the nature that honorable kind of, you know, trade. And I found so moving that thing, and I said, what a beautiful understanding of consider nature a live entity, not just like a piece of trunk or a piece of thing for me to make me feel. It's like when you suddenly realize that you are alive as a plant or as a fish or as an animal or as a tree, then the experience of being alive is enhanced enormously. And that's what I learned from these guys. I was really, really moved by that, you know. It was very shocking to see, you know, when we were shooting in Calgary, all the natives from there, they were telling us that they have never experienced so that weather that we were going through, never in their lives. I saw the difference between 1 degree. The difference of 1 degree, it's literally between water and ice. And we saw how ice melt and obviously every single thing changed, and how the ecosystem was completely different and destroyed and changed and transformed.
Captain! There's no way through! You need to turn back!
We have to keep going!
There's no clear path!
I thought that we were in big trouble, and we did everything we can to finish there. But there was a moment that, in a river scene where the film should end, that when we scout, we were expecting to be absolutely full winter and a lot of snow. They were, you know, yellow grass and bees in a month that supposedly normally historically has been super low temperatures. So there was nothing to do. And then you have to surrender. And yes, it's madness. I truly believe that there's a lot to consider in revenge. The challenge thing for me was that even when in the surface revenge is a driven force, which it is obviously by the pain and by the rage Glass has, I wanted to get through revenge revealing other aspects that could possibly bring the character to realize that there's something better than that, or bigger than that. Or, let me put it this way, for me was to make it clear that revenge, once it's accomplished, it just leaves you empty. And then the meaning of life just collapses. Because if that is your driven force, nothing that you do to damage other people will satisfy you or will bring what you lost.
There's some, you know, powerful themes there for me, because I feel like this was the first sort of denigration of the wilderness, of the environment. This is, you know, the first bits of capitalism at play, this massive fur trade that went to Europe. It was, you know, right after whale oil and right before the gold rush and before we found, you know, these natural resources around the world, you know. It's mankind's first imprint on land in the Americas.
You know, someday you may come back here.
Yeah.
As you get older, you might come back this way to live. So what is it you want to see when you come back here? This is your home. You know, this is your homeland. You have family that has always been here.
There's a war in the system that we have applied to ourselves. There's a war to death. In a way, when there is no protection and nobody is saying this is enough, or now this interest of you to get profit is damaging the community and the society, and you don't protect nothing, then we become animals. We become to the savage era. We become to the primitive era that the big one killed the small one.
I think things like the boom that come in here really just tear up the earth and tear up relationships with people and really just tear up a lot of the beauty of the land that was once here and may not be here. And for me, what I want to see is, I guess, just a betterment of every generation and the generations to come. And I don't know.
How do you want for your kids and your grandkids to live on the reservation when you're all old?
I want them to pick their favorite spot.
Yeah? Live in their favorite spot? Forever?
Sometime when my kids grow up, they'll be a part of me.